morning. Thank you for joining us for worship today. A few announcements to make. In honor of Father's Day today, if you didn't already get one, we have chocolates for all of the fathers here. So, you know, the women get something, we should get something too, right? And so, if you didn't get your chocolate already, be sure to get one in the narthex from Pat or one of the elders before you leave. Let me look at other announcements here. We have VBS this week. We're all set to go. If you haven't been downstairs to look at all the decorating, Chrissy did a great job. It looks awesome. We're ready to go. We do have some openings if people are interested in volunteering. We can, you know, definitely find a place to slot you if you want to show up and volunteer. We would love to have you with that as well. So we're looking forward to this week for that. On June 30th, we have a fireworks celebration in honor of Independence Day. So that will be June 30th. At 6:30, the Owls will start having hot dogs and lemonade and refreshments out in front of the church here. And so it's a nice time of fellowship and then ends with the fireworks display. So join us for that time of fellowship together. And then there's other announcements here. Read through, look through those things. One thing that wasn't in there, we have an opportunity to pick up some free student desks for the school. Chrissy is seeking some volunteers to help get those. That's this Thursday at 9:30, where we would be picking them up from St. John's and Country Club Hills. So if you are free that Thursday and able to come and help get some of those desks, that would be very helpful for setting up our school for the coming year. So if you have any more questions about that, talk to Chrissy for more details. For our service today, we will be using Divine Service Setting 2 on page 167. And we're going to hear throughout the readings that God uses people to proclaim his saving word to the world. He uses prophets, he uses the apostles, and he continues to use pastors today to proclaim this saving word. So we're going to be talking about that ministry of the word throughout the service today, and in the sermon you'll hear about it more. We begin with our opening hymn 646. begin on page 167. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
O Lord, our God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your presence. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and unite us, so that we may abide in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgive you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear you.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Almighty, eternal God, in the word of your apostles and prophets, you have proclaimed to us your saving will. Grant us faith to believe your promises, that we may receive eternal salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Old Testament reading is from Exodus chapter 19, verses 2 through 8. The people of Israel set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain, while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel." So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is from Romans chapter 5, beginning at verse 6. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned, for sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 9th and 10th chapters. Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these: first, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon, the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying, give without pay. Acquire no gold, nor silver, nor copper for your belts, no bag for your journey, nor two tunics, nor sandals, nor a staff, for the laborer deserves his food. And whatever town or village you enter, find out who is worthy in it, and stay there until you depart. As you enter the house, greet it. And if the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. And if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave that house or town. Truly, I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you." This is the Gospel of the Lord. We confess our historic Christian faith using the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. On the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father,
grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Throughout history, God has spread his word to the world through people. It's not usually some magic message that he miraculously downloads into your brain by itself, but rather God calls people to bring his word to the world. Our texts give us an insight into what that ministry of God's called servants often looks like. In the Old Testament, we see God speaking his word through prophets like Moses. The Old Testament text says, "The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, 'Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples. For all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel.' So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him." The ministry of Moses was an incredible ministry. Amazing things he witnessed. The plagues in Egypt, the crossing of the Red Sea on dry ground, God parting the waters, God providing manna, quail, and water in a barren wilderness for the people of Israel. Truly incredible things. He was also tasked with proclaiming the word of God to those people. When God would speak, he would speak through his servant Moses that the people would hear and follow him. Unfortunately, the people he was dealing with were not always faithful. Repeatedly, they would reject the words that Moses brought before them, saying, "We do not trust in God to do these things, to provide for us. In fact, it would be better if we were back in slavery to Egypt." This was the ministry of Moses, both the good and the difficult. In the New Testament time, God spoke his word through his disciples and the apostles. The text says, "These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, 'Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel and proclaim as you go, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying, give without pay. Acquire no gold or silver or copper for your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or staff, for the laborer deserves his food." The 12 were sent out first to proclaim that word of God, summed up in that message, "The kingdom of heaven is at hand." This is the message, if you recall, of John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ, and of Jesus himself in his earthly ministry: "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." The disciples are to continue this proclamation that Jesus, in his incarnation, is the one who brings the kingdom of heaven to you, that you would repent and believe, being saved from sin and death. They also perform amazing miracles: healing the sick, raising the dead, cleansing lepers, casting out demons. All of these miracles, amazing acts of the authority that Christ had given them. And that is exactly how they are able to do this, through the authority of Christ alone. They perform miracles just as he was doing by his sending. They also go without any extra provision. They are not in this in order to get rich or to provide for themselves, but they are sent out in order to preach the word and save souls. They don't bring provisions, for it is the people who they stay with that Christ says will provide all that they need for their ministry. But just like Moses, not everyone liked what these disciples had to say. Jesus continues in the text, "And if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave that house or town. Truly, I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them and the Gentiles." Many would hear the preaching of the apostles throughout the early church and reject it. We see this often in the book of Acts, that the people that the apostles preached to, often the Jews and the unbelievers, will not listen to the fact that Jesus is God in the flesh, who died for them and rose to life to save them. They would arrest him, beat him, mock him, and even put them to death for this proclamation of the truth. Jesus lays out the judgment for those who reject the word of the apostles. This eternal judgment, worse than the judgment given to Sodom and Gomorrah. A harsh judgment. Yet even when these apostles are told of what they will face, they go and preach so that people may believe in God and be saved. And we get a beautiful picture of that saving message in the epistle text today. St. Paul tells us, "For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since, therefore, we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life." You see, Jesus, when he looked down upon creation before coming into this world, did not look and see a people that were righteous and worthy of the salvation that he would bring. But what he sees are ungodly people, sinners, enemies of God, rebels against the will of his Father. And yet he comes to die for you anyway. While you were still weak, Christ comes and gives his pure, holy life that you would be forgiven of all of your sins and granted life everlasting. This is the preaching of the prophets, of the apostles. This is what God's word is all about. Christ's death and resurrection for the salvation of your souls. But what about today? Is that word still proclaimed to the world? It most certainly is. Today, God speaks his word through pastors. God continues to call men who believe in him to proclaim his word. You, here at Holy Cross, have received the ministry of such men: Pastor Hess, Pastor Metzger, and many others who have served this flock. I am simply the next servant called by God to serve you, the saints, here in this place. And pastors, myself included, are tasked by God to preach that word. We preach that word of gospel, that Jesus died on the cross for you and for all of the world, that you would be saved. We also preach the word of law. that we call out sin and proclaim to you often, sometimes, things you may not like to hear. But pastors must preach the full truth of God, whether it's comfortable to hear or uncomfortable. For we do not answer to the people of this world, but we answer to God Himself. We do not do this ministry, preach this word, in order to gain provisions for ourselves or to get rich by this ministry. We do not say to you, if you give me enough money, then God will bless you. Or if you give me some money, well, then I will do a private mass for you, and that will forgive you of your sins and pay the right price. I will only forgive your sins if you up my salary and benefits. Please and thank you. This is not what pastors are called to preach. Rather, we are called to preach the pure truth of God's word that souls may be saved and faith be strengthened. We enter this ministry because God has called us to this work, and we seek to be faithful instruments of God in His saving of the lost. We also see in our text a very important part of this ministry is not just the calling of the pastors, but the call of the faithful stewardship of those who hear the word. For the laborer deserves his food or is worthy of his provision. This provision, this stewardship that is provided by you, the flock, with your time, with your talents, with your treasures, your tithing, these provisions and this faithful stewardship allows the pastor and the church to perform the ministry of God to our fullest. To provide for the pastor allows me to dedicate my time to the flock, to preaching God's word, to doing Bible studies, to teach you more of that scripture, that I may study and learn more as I have a lot more to learn, I trust I tell you, to visit you when you are sick or in the hospital, to comfort you when you have a loved one who dies. This is part of the benefits of such faithful stewardship. It is also by your stewardship that the ministries of this church are able to flourish. Such things like Kids for Christ, VBS, our school, all of these ministries of the church are from your stewardship. And it is by this stewardship that you primarily give thanks to God. God has given you everything that you have. We confess as Lutherans about our first article gifts. Luther explains in the Small Catechism that it is God who gives us everything we have, our body, soul, eyes, ears, all our members, our reason, and all of our senses, and still takes care of them. He gives us clothing and shoes, food and drink, house and home, wife, children, land, animals, and everything I have. God gives us everything. So giving back 10% of what he has given shouldn't be too big of an ask. It is this stewardship to the church of your time, your talents, and your treasures that helps the proclaiming of the gospel to go forth from the pastor and from all the ministries of this church. We hear in our text today that pastors continue in that work that has been done throughout history, the work of Moses, of the prophets, of the apostles, the proclaiming of God's word. We preach that word even when people don't want to hear it or think it's too basic. Pastor, we've heard that before. Find something new to preach. Pastors care for God's people, even when those people try and find the littlest things to get annoyed about and complain against the pastor. Pastors face hardship, both outside the church and within the church, all that you may hear that saving word of Christ, that the kingdom of heaven draws near in the person of Jesus himself. And so may you gladly hear that word proclaimed to you, that you would receive that saving word and that peace may come with it. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand for the prayer of the church. Almighty God, we give thanks for all your goodness and bless you for the love that sustains us from day to day. We praise you for the gift of your Son, our Savior, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, for your Holy Church, for the means of grace, for the lives of all faithful and just people, and for the hope of the life to come. Help us to treasure in our hearts all that you have done for us, and enable us to show our thankfulness in lives that are wholly given to your service. Lord, in your mercy, save and defend your whole church, purchased with the precious blood of Christ. Strengthen your faithful people through the word and the holy sacraments, making them perfect in love and in all good works, and establishing in them the faith once delivered to the saints. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant your wisdom and heavenly grace to all pastors and to those who hold office in your church, that by their devoted service, faith may abound and your kingdom increase. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Send the light of your truth into all the earth. Raise up faithful servants of Christ to advance the gospel, both at home and in distant lands. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In your mercy, strengthen newly established congregations and support them in challenging times. Make them steadfast, abounding in the work of the Lord, and let their faith and zeal for the gospel refresh and renew the witness of your people everywhere. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Preserve our nation in justice and honor, that we may lead a peaceable life with integrity. Grant health and favor to all who bear office in our land, especially the President and Congress of the United States, the Governor and Legislature of this state, and to all those who make, administer, and judge our laws. Help them to serve this people according to your holy will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Take from us all hatred and prejudice. Give us the spirit of love and order our days in your peace. Prosper the labor of those who work to bring peace and justice to the nations of the world, that mutual understanding and common endeavor may be increased among all peoples. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless the schools of the church and all colleges, universities, and centers of research, and those who teach and work in them. Grant your wisdom in such measure that people may serve you honorably in church and state, and that our common life may be conformed to the ways of your truth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sanctify our homes with your presence and bless them with joy. Keep our children in the covenant of their baptism and enable their parents to bring them up in lives of faith and devotion. Be with the fathers in this place and around the world, that they would be faithful to you and fulfill their vocation steadfastly. Unite the members of all families in a spirit of affection and service, that they may show your praise in our land and in all the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let your blessing remain upon the seed time and harvest, the commerce and industry, the leisure and rest, the arts and culture of our people. Take under your special protection those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and be with all who put their hands to any useful task. Give them the just rewards for their labor, and the knowledge that their work is a blessing in your sight. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for safe travel for all of those headed to the LWML convention. We pray that their time will be blessed by you and their faith strengthened, and that through them, your work would continue in this country and in this world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
By your word and Holy Spirit, comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. We especially pray for Whitney, Eddie, Judy, Steve, Frank, Alan, Rebecca, Mike, Marv, Ann, Darlene, Edith, Roy, and all of our shut-ins. Be with those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those to whom death draws near. Bring consolation to those in sorrow, and grant to all a measure of your love, taking them into your tender care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things, and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the offering. We continue with the service of the sacrament on page 177. Please stand.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
think that it's the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who shall be your sins.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Please stand for the Nunc Dimittis on page 182. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.